Welcome to week 10 of our 2790. This is going to be our going deeper section. We're going to talk a little bit about Thessalonians, and I'm going to talk in a broader perspective about the Apostle Paul. Paul writes to the Thessalonian church. He loves this church. He says that their faith has been sounded forth through the entire region, and he's very proud of them and very caring for them. And in this particular church, there doesn't seem to be a lot of behavioral or moral things that he needs to change, but there is a theological point that he wants to make with the people. That theological point is that Jesus is coming again. He wants to correct someone who's misspoken to the church. Someone's told the Thessalonian church that Jesus has already returned and he's left. And so they're distraught over that. And so the Apostle Paul says, no, that hasn't happened. You're not going to know when Jesus comes back. He's going to come like a thief in the night. And then Paul introduces the man of lawlessness, and he says to them that this has to happen first, and there are a whole bunch of signs and a lot of things that need to happen. He tries to calm them down that they didn't miss the boat. And so what I want to do is compare the first time that Jesus came with his second coming. The first time that Jesus came, he came for the purpose of salvation. He came to die on the cross so that he could offer the forgiveness of sin, original sin and personal sin. By his blood, we are forgiven. He came, and because of that cross, it empowered him to give the Holy Spirit into our hearts that would confirm the truth that Jesus actually did that. That was his purpose. He came to create this new covenant of grace, and he came to save us. When he comes again, he's not coming for salvation. He's not coming to preach the gospel. He's not coming to die on the cross again. That was once and for all. When he comes again, riding a white horse like a great hero, he's going to come for the harvest. And he's going to receive believers unto himself, that where he is, there we might be also. And he's going to take us home. And for the rest, they're going to face his judgment and his wrath. Anyone who's not a believer will face his wrath. There are two books, and we'll see these when we read Revelation, two books that are going to be open when Jesus returns, the book of deeds and the book of life. All of my deeds are written in the book of deeds. All of your deeds are written in the book of deeds. All of a non-believer's deeds are written in the book of deeds. The things that we did that were good, the things that we did that were not good, the things that we were supposed to do that were good that we didn't do, and the things that we were tempted to do we shouldn't do that we actually didn't do. And so all of that's in there. The difference between a believer and a non-believer is that at the judgment, as my book of deeds is open and we're going, you know, the Lord and I are going through my life, right at the moment of wrath, right when I'm getting ready to get what I deserve because I'm a sinful man, Jesus is my advocate. He steps in between me and what I deserve, and he takes that punishment upon himself, puts his arms around me and says, this one is mine, and I get to go home to heaven. But a non-believer, they don't have Jesus. They're on their own. All they have is the book of deeds. My name is written in the book of life. Theirs is not. And that comes when we believe Jesus as Lord and Savior. And so there's a great difference between the two comings of the Lord Jesus Christ. And one of the things that I would recommend, and I think this is a really cool idea, when at Christmas time, I think it would be a really good idea for you to create a symbol, something that makes you think about Jesus coming again, and put that ornament, that second coming ornament, on your Christmas tree so that you can have an anticipation of our Holy Lord coming to receive us unto the heavens. I now want to just talk for a minute or two about the Apostle Paul in general. When we first began, I told you that Paul says a lot of things that can be troubling. He says things that are troubling to people whose marriages are in trouble. He says things that are troubling to people who have been divorced. He says things that are troubling to people who are in sexual relationships and not married. He says things that are troubling to women in general. And so he says a lot of things that stir the pot and ire people up. And what I want to do is I want to encourage you, before you simply discard everything that Paul says, I would ask that you simply sit down and ask the Holy Spirit to give you some guidance, and ask the Holy Spirit to lead you into what is true and right and holy. I'll give you just one example of how this might help you. You know, the Apostle Paul says, that women should submit to their husband, and he says it on three occasions. And since it's not just to one church or one circumstances, it seems more general than that. Peter even talks about it. It seems to me that we should pay attention to this. And I've learned over the years that when I say this, there's usually one or two responses that a woman would have. I've had women just get up in the middle, as soon as I read it, just get up and leave, because they can't fathom that someone like me, educated at Princeton, would believe that a woman should humble herself to a man, that we don't live in that kind of world today. And I understand women's rights and trying to be equal, and it's been unfair. I get all that. That's not what Paul's talking about. You know, and sometimes women have been abused by men, and they just don't understand how God would expect them to be humble in that situation. Sometimes it's emotional, physical, even spiritual abuse haranguing upon them. And so they feel that it would be better to walk away or to not humble themselves to that. And I totally get the human side of this. And if a person is married to an ungodly man, if a woman's married to an ungodly man, I get walking away. I truly do. But if both people are godly and the man is genuinely trying to lead a humble life, then this makes sense. In fact, not only does it make sense, I've learned that there are many women who love this idea. It is freedom for them. And so I want to encourage you just to give the Holy Spirit a chance as you read through the Apostle Paul. Don't just throw it all out because you don't like what it says. Remember the warning I gave you. When the truth impacts us, one of the things that we tend to want to do is discard the messenger or discard the source. And the way we do that is through ad hominem attacks. We attack the messenger or the writer of the source. We look at that person's life. We do it all the time. We look at that person's life and we criticize their life, but we don't really talk about whether or not it's true, because we don't want to deal with whether or not the truth is the truth. We don't want that to challenge us and transform us, when in fact, that's exactly what God wants. He wants to transform us so that all of us, men and women alike, lead gentle, quiet, and humble lives. That's God's purpose for all of us.